God, oh my God.
In this episode, Confidential is doing it by numbers. Two time streams, two Sonics, one cracking coat, one set of smoking wheels.
By the end of today, I'm going to be driving that.
And a scarily large amount of tea.
I'm really excited, but looking at them like now, the fact I'm going to be in there is it's pretty terrifying. Someone does actually have massive tea.
And there's some great relationship stuff in this episode. We find out a lot.
And we've got access all areas as Karen kicks some serious bot. The Who crew is in the studio, about to film a double Amy defence against an aggressive android attack.
When old Amy is saying, "Go on, I've got your back," we are seeing this one has come back to life.
So there's a threat to her.
So there's a type, so that can delay and let Amy just go as soon as she said, "Go on, I've got your back."
Okay, cool.
Here we go. Let's turn over, please. Here we go.
And on set to lend a hand is stunt coordinator Crispin Layfield.
Try to teach her a few little moves to make her look a bit cool, spinning the sword around and the staff, and it's just a big movement just to make her look like she's, you know, she knows exactly what she's doing.
I think Amy is becoming a bit of an action hero.
I've got your back!
Nick presented us with the idea that he was going to do one long, continuous shot of me basically taking all the hand bots out in the most elaborate ways possible.
It wasn't necessarily a big fight scene between each individual handbot. You just had to make Karen look super cool and with her sword and her staff. So we all shot it all in slow-mo and tracked along the side of Karen's. And I had two stunt girls being the handbots, so they fell over when they got hit. And then the other handbots, they just got various different moves with Karen for the swords and the staff.
It was just really satisfying taking out robots, I have to say. I really enjoyed it. I kept forgetting there were actual girls inside those handbots, though. Sorry.
Because it's so slow, and all when she moves her head, all the hair moves around, and the big sweeping movements with the sword and the staff, and when we actually make contact against the handbots, you know, the stunt people, and they're falling over, it all looks really, really crisp and clear. So it's just a great visual, you know, move. So the big movement's the better, because it makes her look a lot more powerful.
This is the end, beautiful friend. This is the end, my only friend, the end.
A fun thing about Amy is that she has the potential for to be an action hero and quite dangerous and deadly all the time. Push comes to shove, she'll shoot you. You know, she has that sort of she's got that James Bond thing going on. You know, she can be quite ruthless. She can be quite hard.
Throw the gun down.
And you push Amy into a corner like she's pushed you in this show, and she'll turn into that. I absolutely believe that, and I rather love it. I rather love it that she's a. She's potentially a very dangerous girl.
Bash the door.
Interface?
I am here, Amy Bond.
Shh. Turn that light off. So I'm... What is this? How does it work?
This is the gate. From here, you may depart to any of two streams' entertainment zones.
This gave Confidential an idea. If Karen and Arthur had a holodeck to play with, what daredevil dream would they fulfill? So we asked Arthur, and he said he wanted to do this. Whilst Karen, who's never had a driving lesson in her whole life, wanted to do this.
Yo. So, I travel all of time and space with the doctor on a regular basis, but one thing that I've never actually learned to do is to drive. So, by the end of the day, on this racetrack, I'm going to learn how to drive that. Okay, well, hi, Pat.
Hi.
Hi. So, you're going to teach me the basics?
I am, most definitely.
I've never driven before in my entire life.
Well, it's going to be fun. I'm sure we're going to be fine.
Yeah?
So, I'm going to teach you how to drive on a race circuit. So, now we need a few revs with the accelerator. So, with the right foot, just a few revs. That's it. Perfect.
Oh, my God.
And then what we do is we very, very gently then let our foot off the clutch and just to get the car moving.
Oh, no.
Am I not moving? Go on. No, here we go. No. Here we go. We're moving. We're moving. It's a good start.
Oh, my God. Please don't stall.
Steer over to the left a little bit. Perfect. How was that? That was all right, wasn't
okay.
it?
Okay.
Your first time pulling away and you didn't stall. Right, with the steering, we just need to look at where we want to go. And it's that hand-eye coordination. Let's just have a little bit of a weave around. Just move the steering left and right. Just get a feel for what it does.
Okay, I've still got my foot on the clutch.
Yeah, you can take that all the way off now and just rest that to the left.
Okay. So, all right, cool. Around. So, oh, God.
Okay.
Woo!
So we want to go a little bit faster. All
can
we do
go a bit
is,
faster?
Yeah, we just press the gas pedal.
Oh, my God, this
brilliant.
Is crazy.
Well done. Right, now what we need to do, we need to do a U-turn. So we need to get turn around. So off the gas, so off the accelerator.
Oh, yeah.
So right foot off.
Yeah.
So move over to the all the way over to the far side. And then what you've got to do is you've got to swing the steering wheel round to the left. So swing it round. Go on, keep going, keep going, keep it going. A bit more. Keep it going. Just stay at that. You're doing fine. That's perfect. That's easy. It's driving, isn't it? Now straighten the steering up again. So look at where you want to go. Move it to
there
where you
go.
Want to go. Now we can press
accelerator.
The gas again. Now you can accelerate again.
Woo! Let's do this.
Lewis Hamilton.
I am
eat
Lewis
your
Hamilton.
Heart out.
Yeah, exactly. Button.
Yeah, no problem at all. That's fine. We're only in first gear, but hey, we're getting there. It's a good place to start. But what we might need is second gear if we're going to go much faster. So remember, clutch down, off the gas, pull the gear lever back. So clutch down.
Into second.
Off the clutch.
Off the clutch. Okay. And then we're off. Oh, no, sorry.
All the way off the clutch.
Oh, my God, that's it's going brilliant. Faster.
That's it, because we're in second gear.
Oh.
So just
goodness.
Take your time. And that's a good speed to do. So we're doing 35, 40 miles an hour.
I'm doing 35 miles an hour.
Yeah. Okay.
Whoa, I can't believe this.
So you're actually driving round the fastest race circuit in the UK now.
Oh, my God! I can't believe I'm actually doing this.
Yeah.
Like, I'm just doing a lap on a racetrack in a car.
You're getting the hang of this driving, arm on the door.
Yeah.
On
let's go pick up some chicks. Confidential! Look at that! Woo! Yeah.
But don't forget to look where you're going.
So, Pat, how did I do?
Honest answer?
Honest answer.
Really good. I think he did an absolute star. Did
yes!
really, really well this morning.
Oh, thanks.
So good, we're going to let you out in this one this
oh
afternoon.
My good God!
So you're going from 90 horsepower to 420 horsepower.
Oh, right.
So, pretty cool.
The Millennium Centre in Cardiff is doubling as the Alien Twin Streams facility. A place which creates twice the trouble for Amy Pond.
Welcome to the Two Streams facility.
With double the Amys, you need double the actresses.
Who's she? There's no one else here, but... me?
But as there's only one Karen Gillan, this meant filming with a body double and shooting everything twice. Once with Amy.
How about Amy One speaks first?
Which one's Amy One?
And once with the other Amy.
I am.
No, I am. Rory! Rory, just stop doing that.
Because we had to film things twice, you know, once with her, you know, as she is, and once with her. In the prosthetic, it kind of gives you a bit more time. So although we had a lot to do, we got to do it quite a few times.
So with both Amy's tooled up, the girls get ready to get handy with the handbots.
Do not be
incoming!
Alarmed. This is a kindness.
With me.
Do not be alarmed.
Belinda's through.
This is a kindness. This is a kindness.
Amy.
Deactivate.
Kate Haler, your turn, hockey.
Over the shins.
How's it going, Conf? Just enjoying a nice coffee on this fine morning.
Just texting.
He's always texting, this one. He's a phone addict. Yeah, we're in the Millennium Centre right now, and it's really nice because the weather is good, and we're working continuous days with no lunch break, which means that we finish at 4 o'clock.
And we eat lunch.
We eat lunch. It's a win-win situation. I'm back to being myself today. Well, not myself. I'm not actually Amy, but my younger self today, which is quite fun. Yesterday, I got up, right, at 4 in the morning to come to work for prosthetics. It's crazy. Tomorrow, it's 3 in the morning. Morning!
Good morning!
Good morning.
Good morning. Hello, Confidential.
It was really strange the first time that we did it, actually, because it was like a flash into the future, and I do not age well. What are those wrinkles though? Is that my actual skin or is it the...
Well, the forehead is a prosthetic, but...
Yeah.
But the stuff on your eyes is your skin. So the latex doesn't stretch as much as your skin.
Hello again. What an improvement. This episode in particular is just crazily busy because I'm playing two different characters. Even though they're the same person, they're really, really different. But I volunteered myself to play older Amy. I believe they were going to cast an older woman to play the part. I was like, no, please. And they let me.
Well, it was a big debate. There always is when you're going to have somebody older. Is either you put up with the fact it's clearly not them. Let's be honest. When you cast somebody else as an older version of somebody, you never think it's the same person. You never, ever think it's the same person. Alternatively, you have them wear a rubber hood. And you still maybe don't quite buy that it's them. Yeah, I'd rather take that hit than take the hit of not believing or investing in that person as Amy. I'm very, very glad we went in that direction because more than anything, it was a chance for Karen to show her stuff, to do that different body language and that different vocal register. A real chance for her to show off just what she's got as an actress.
The fun part was creating a whole new character, getting to play the one I already play, but then kind of linking them as well. So old Amy has tiny little... You catch tiny, tiny glimpses of young Amy.
They look ridiculous.
That's what I told him. Still, anything beats a fez, eh? It was like acting with an older version of Karen, which was... It was amazing, and it was only when we started watching a few bits back in the edit of scenes where they're both together, the younger and old Amy, you see the subtle difference in her performance. It's brilliant, and it's really, really quite amazing to watch, and she really, really smashed it.
You're asking me to defy destiny, causality, the nexus of time itself for a boy. You're Amy.
he's Rory.
Karen's had to really work hard to create the two Amys. And she worked with a voice coach and a movement coach to work out how she would, you know, look and feel at 36 years older.
Yeah, she did loads of physical work and, you know, worked with the movement director on how to walk and how to, you know, walk like a tough guy, which she did very well. But yeah, she's become some kind of action hero.
I don't have a sonic screwdriver because I'm not off on a romp. I call it what it is, a probe, and I call my life what it is. Hell.
It's one of the best performances she's turned in while she's been on Doctor Who, and, you know, because she makes very subtle choices about the older Amy, and you feel so sorry for her because she's sort of clinging on to her youth somehow, but, you know, she does something very interesting with her eyes and her voice, and I just think it's a very intelligent, mature performance from Karen, and it's exciting. It's a brilliantly stylized episode anyway, and has great style, and she comes up trumps. Well done, Kaz. You rocked it, dude.
You didn't save me.
But this is the saving! This is the us saving you! The doctor just got the timing a bit out!
Can I touch your face?
Yeah.
Yeah. Actually, it feels a bit nicer than your real face.
Look at this. Got a really good angle there.
That's a great chin.
They're going to be going wild at home now.
Oh, yeah.
Watching that going, oh, my goodness. It's come true.
What, that I've aged really badly?
Yes. I think you've aged well.
Oh, I've got to go and put my armour on. Enough of this titter-tatter, is that you?
Hey, Confidential. Now, in Doctor Who, Rory's done some pretty exciting things and some pretty terrifying things. You know, he's battled with Daleks, he's travelled in time. He's done some crazy stuff. But something that both excites and terrifies me is the idea of swimming with sharks, which I shall be doing today in this building here. So I'm going to go and see how big their teeth are. I'm really excited, but looking at them like now, the fact I'm going to be in there is pretty terrifying. Well, I used to be scared of killer whales. I used to think one was going to come up the toilet. It's a long story. And then, I don't know, I just think they're fascinating, look at them. I've been snorkeling a few times and always been like, oh, is there going to be a shark? And I've always wanted to, you know, it's quite nice seeing one in a controlled environment. I think if I saw one in the wild, I would freak out. So it's quite nice to get over. Oh, they're so amazing, look at that.
So now that Arthur's whet his appetite for sharks, it's time to sink his teeth into some proper underwater action.
Okay, so now you have to wear this. What it will do, this camera at the front will give everybody a perspective of exactly what you're seeing, the hero. Have you tried putting it on?
Yeah, let's try. I'm going to look great in this.
I want one now. There you go. Okay, just does up at the bottom like that.
Wonderful. I feel like I'm kind of 6 years old on a bike.
Looking good.
That's ridiculous. Great, thanks, guys. And not only am I terrified, I look really cool. It's like something from James Bond, just walking into a pool of massive sharks. I'm fairly nervous, but I don't know. Having all of this feels a bit like armour. Strange, and this, of course, my anti-shark. I'm pretty nervous, but I'm quite excited. I think I may have a moment of freaking out. Don't film that. Really. As long as they don't like bump into me, I think I'll be all right. I got in there and thought I'd freak out and just started laughing, and it was really hard to use the equipment properly because I was just laughing through my nose making bubble because there were just massive sharks all around me. strange thing about being underwater is that it's just so peaceful, and I sound really chilled out because I am. Because it was actually really, it was less terrifying and more just really relaxing. Just getting down to the floor and just them swimming so close to you, like close as you could, you know, and I really, so I'm glad they said don't touch them beforehand, because I really would have, at a few points, just reached out and tried to stroke a shark. But they're very cool. It's the ones that move really slowly that really freak me out. The ones that kind of swim past are kind of like, oh, wow, shark. And there's some that just come and they're like, oh, no, he's looking at me. He's looking at me. He's going to go for me. And then there's these ones with these teeth that just stick out, which after a while became hilarious, but first freaked me out. And they actually gave me a tooth, a shark's tooth from one of the sharks that I was swimming with. Look at this one. It's coming around with his big old teeth. All right. Great, and they're huge. They're much bigger than I thought they were going to be. There's some really big ones. They're so nosy. They kind of come up to you and try and say hello. It's great. I would recommend it to anyone. It's fascinating. I could have stayed down there all day.
There's some weird underwater general fix there. It's just great. Thank you. Thank you, Confidential. Making my dreams come true.
The robots are coming.
The thing about the handbots is they actually look quite... They don't look that scary, but it's what they do. It's the fact that they've got these kind of blank faces and these, and, you know, these hands that you can't... that you can't touch.
Bend.
They're just constantly after you. They're constantly trying to help. And, yeah, just relentlessly trying to touch you, which would, you know, make you pass out.
Oh.
And in some ways, it's more scary than something that's kind of, you know, actually purposely trying to attack you.
Will you be visiting long?
Good question. A bit sinister. What's the answer to not get us killed?
I'm Tom the writer.
Hello.
You're the first handbot I've seen. Very nice to meet you. Look at that. So my idea was originally that they were in just in clothes with these hands sticking out and then this kind of the face like that. And then it's developed into this full bodysuit, which is wonderful. I didn't think that we'd have so much to play with. And also we've got six of them, which is very good.
Oh, yes.
Ha! You don't like that, do you?
The handbots aren't traditionally monsters in that they're not trying to hurt or kill or conquer. They're just there to help. They're kind of like the administrator droids. They're the maintenance staff of this facility. And they're just there to help.
Oh, I mean, robots are also a huge kind of part of Doctor, a huge part of sci-fi. And one of the hardest things we had to do was find a design for the handbots that hadn't been done before.
Hey! Oi! Wait!
We wanted to find something that seemed, when you first met them, quite benign and quite pleasant. It was only later, when they decided that you needed to be cured, that they got a bit scary.
You are carrying unregistered bacteria. Please let me help you.
You know, you've got to have a good robot in sci-fi. And the doctors, you know, I'm sure, seen plenty and got plenty more to come.
No, I'm not from this world. Your medicine will kill me.
Statement rejected. Do not be alarmed. This is a kindness.
No, no, please, I hate needles.
The cast and crew are at the Doctor Who studios, where the robot stunt team, the two Amys and Rory, are set to prepare for battle once again. But today also sees a new arrival.
This is my first day in my new coat. Been campaigning for a new coat.
We've been waiting a long time to wear this new coat, Jace, haven't we?
It's been many months in the making.
Well, you missed the tweet. Is it tweet?
Oh, no, the tweet will be in.
It'll be in.
The tweet will never leave. The tweet will always be there.
I like it. It's kind of like an overcoat, slightly.
Yeah, it's more overcoaty than the last.
Yeah.
But it's cool, right?
I mean, we're not going to see it.
The new coat thing, man.
All right.
Do you like
it? It's a good idea.
I might get one made for myself in navy. Nice. Yeah, I've got a little sonic pocket there.
Specifically?
Yeah.
Did they put that in because of
Yeah.
But Matt isn't the only one with new dapper threads.
Let's show them your new costume.
Okay, so cool pink leather jacket.
Yep.
Bit of a spotty shirt.
I'm loving these trousers.
Then,
they're very explore-ish.
Yeah, they are.
Lara Croft.
Zips.
Pity about the face. I'm Lara Croft.
Oh.
Angelina Jolie.
He's humorous. Didn't you say one time that I was a little bit like Angelina Jolie?
I said you could play an action hero.
I think you did.
You don't look.
And then you referenced Angelina Jolie.
There he is. Oh,
he's just being checked.
I'm being checked by Jason.
Perfectly in place.
Jason. Yep.
That's Jason. The checker. So, yeah, but I really like it. I think that it's good. I like the colour, colour.
Thanks.
And it looks like a sort of old man's overcoat slightly. And also the way you move as you know, the doctor, the coat is really going to complement that.
Well,
it's going to swish around.
I really hope it maintains the element of the geek. That's the
key. You will always have that element.
Okay. And you will never be Angelina Jolie. And on that note...
Hi, my name's Steve Rees and I'm the A-camera focus puller on Doctor Who. I've done 77 episodes so far and this will be my 78th episode. It's my job to try and keep the camera in focus all the time. Focus is done remotely by handset and then that gives me a chance to stand away from the camera and get a better view of what's happening and gives me the ability to judge the distance between the camera and the subject.
Astrid. Cut it!
So that was pretty good. She came into 4 foot exactly, which I hit, which is brilliant. Headed off to the background, 15 foot, so that was a good take.
Nick, if I'm panning Karen in,
yes.
Is that still all right to paint everything out?
Yeah.
Fine. This one's me, camera only, so I'm going to get a cup of tea. To the Sour Boys, Dav and Bryn. We've got a pet in the camera department. His name's Snuggy.
It's for the shoulder.
He's quite tame. He's got a good set of teeth on him, but he's very tame. Yeah. And he's quite tolerant as well, because he gets a heavy camera put on his back and he doesn't complain at all. We're shooting the camera at high speed now, 50 frames per second. The normal speed, it takes 25 photographs every second. Now we're running at 50 frames per second. When you play it back at normal speed, everything's half speed. That means we've got to put the deck on the back of the camera. Unfortunately, that increases the weight of the camera up to about 35 kilos. So it's a little bit uncomfortable to hold handheld, but Owen's quite strong and he's taking his jumper off. We should be okay now.
To go to a very shallow depth on this.
32, no problem.
I'm trying to dry the background as much out of focus.
No problem.
As
well. Okay.
Set and action!
Bit of a tricky one at slow motion and Owen's running backwards. So the distance is constantly moving, it's very difficult to gauge.
Cut it. Okay. Very good. I'll just check that.
Yeah, just watching that back now. We can watch it back normal speed on this. So let's see the effect the slow-mo has, which is good. Lovely. Yeah, looks good. Wow, that's a wrap. It's been a long day. There'll be more of the same tomorrow. But thanks a lot for watching and enjoy Doctor Who.
Confidential has taken Karen to one of the UK's fastest race circuits to learn to drive. This morning she got up to second gear in a 90 horsepower runabout, but now it's time to graduate to a 420 horsepower beast.
All right, a
Let's drive.
Are you sitting comfortably?
I am, are you?
We shall begin. It's good. Perfect. Just hold it at that. It'll come back to the red one. Wait for the red one and then turn. No need to brake. You're fine at that. Look for the green one. Okay. Out to the red cone. Stay at the red one. And then gently come over to the right now. That's perfect. It's a long, long corner, this one. It seems to go on forever.
Yeah.
If you get it right. If you get it wrong, it can be very short, but I wouldn't recommend it. There you go, that's great. Another 60 miles an hour through the corner.
Woohoo!
So, middle of the road.
Middle of the road.
Just kiss the middle of the road, then we come back over to the left. And you can go a bit faster.
Oh my God!
Brilliant.
All right.
All right, now we're cooking. Over to the left. Then we come to the middle of the road. Stay in the middle.
Oh, yeah.
That's it. Perfect. You're fine. Wait for the cone. Then turn gently. Bit more to the yellow one. That's all right. You're fine. Wait for the red one. Wait for the red one very gently. Go on, frighten that yellow one a bit. Onto the accelerator now. Look at the green one. Go on, accelerate up. Go on, faster. Go on. Go on. We're doing 100 miles an hour.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, that. Off the accelerator now. Just hold it up there. That's perfect. Absolute perfect. And relax. You can breathe.
Yeah, I forgot.
Over to the left. Great. And we've got to stop here. Just there would be perfect. And stop at that. Karen,
yes.
That is absolutely fantastic.
That was.
In fact, you've done so well.
Oh, thanks.
Do you want to swap seats?
Yeah.
And I'll take you around.
Yeah, show me some real driving.
Does that sound good?
That sounds amazing.
Good. There we go, 120 miles an hour.
No! Why have you done this to me, Confidential? That's lovely! Woohoo! This is better than any roller coaster. I've never experienced anything like this in my life. It was worth it though. Oh my God.
Last week, we found the Einstein for our winning episode of Doctor Who. Now a storyboard artist starts to bring the script to life.
Storyboard is pretty much the script of an episode done as a comic book. I break the story down into a series of panels, and then they're there to give guidance to the director for how shots should be set up, and obviously he can see those drawings that I've done and go through and work out, well, that works, that doesn't work, we can change that a bit, before having to go through all the rigmarole of setting up the kit and getting things filmed and fighting. It doesn't quite work yet, but if you've got the drawings beforehand, it's a much easier way of getting things rolling.
Mike is joined by Jeremy and the director of photography to plan the shots that will bring the story from script to screen.
Okay, so here's a storyboard for tomorrow's shoot. We can just run through it and we'll just see how many shots we got. Mm. So we'll start off with this wide shot here. Big wide of the TARDIS on the crane. Roughly that position. We might find a better one on the day, but you know, great big wide lens, maybe sort of 16.
Yeah, 16 mil, and sort of sweep, sort of so sweeping all around.
Yeah, this is the real sort of probably the opening shot, the sequence of the Doctor running up the stairs, you know, being very enthusiastic about his fares.
Action.
Oh, I missed you. I can't believe River blew you up. Whoa.
Okay.
I didn't mean to do that.
I like to talk through the storyboard with the director of photography, so she's got a good idea of what I've got in my head. She'll then be able to work out where lights need to be put, where certain camera angles need to be from.
How about there? But not with so much of the console in, nicely framed, but about there?
One of the great things about being a storyboard artist is you sit in a little room, you do your little doodles, and then when you see it on the big screen, people actually moving where you've put them in your drawings. That's priceless.
Filming day, and our young writers arrive on set to meet Matt Smith.
Hello, Ben.
Oh, wow. Hi, Ben.
What's your name?
Hi, Daniel.
I'm Matt.
Hello,
pleasure
Daniel.
To meet you. Well done.
Adam,
that have written it?
Katie.
Wow, well done. And what's your name?
Congratulations. Fantastic
Daniel,
script.
Well done. Thank you for this. And what's your name?
Adam.
Hello, I'm Matt.
I'm Katie.
And you're Katie. So, how old are you all?
10.
You're all 10?
No, I'm 9.
You're 9. And had you any idea how to write a script before this came along?
Sort of, not.
Yeah.
Yes.
How?
So we did it in English.
Right.
But we didn't really know how to write a proper script.
Yeah. Well, it's so clever. We're all just bowled
really
over
great,
by
it.
I mean, do you think you want to be writers when you grow up?
Possibly, yeah.
Oh well, you know. Well done.
Yeah, it's been great.
Round of applause.
Next week, rehearsals begin. Back in the studio, Confidential witnesses the end of a 36-year-old survival story.
496, take one.
Thank you, Martha. Help me down. Let's turn over, please.
Heavy breathing, everybody. Breathing.
And action.
Panics. Four. A, your eyes, I think, should be still.
Yeah, did I close them?
Yeah.
Should I kick both doors open?
By that time, we'll cut inside to you coming in. So I'd just love to be aware for two more paces of the look in Rory's face.
The script really gave Arthur great material to explore and work with, and I mean, he's a fine actor and delivers a very moving performance, because obviously they're both Amy, you know, and I think particularly when he's up by the TARDIS door and she's outside, the old Amy, and I think he really delivers brilliantly on that.
Arthur carries the emotional weight of this story, and I think he really rose to the challenge. He did a brilliant job. Rory really has to choose at the end and make a horrible, horrible decision as to who he wants to be with.
I'm sorry. She's not real.
She is real. Let her in.
Look, we take this Amy, we leave ours. There can only be one Amy in the TARDIS. Which one do you want?
Getting to that point where when they go into the TARDIS and the Doctor actually turns around and goes, well, no, you can't. You can't do this. It's, you know, it's huge. And it's a big thing for their relationship, even though it's, you know, Amy in 36 years' time or whatever. It's still her doing it and her saying it. And it's one of the hardest situations Rory's ever been in.
It's your choice. This isn't fair. You're turning me into you.
I guess the way Rory looks at young Amy
is something that really triggers something in old Amy, because she remembers it and she can almost feel like young Amy again, but she knows that she's not.
Amy, I love you.
I love you too. She sacrifices her own life for her younger self, which kind of is a different person to her. In my eyes anyway, I sort of see them as two different characters, even though they're the same person. They've led two very different lives, and therefore it's kind of made them completely different.
I've forgotten how much she loved me. She doesn't deserve what I've become. Give her the days I can't have. Please don't let me in.
Rory's constant quest to make everyone all right and everyone happy. In this instance, he can't do it, and I think it really, really affects him.
No, she'll never have existed.
But I lied to her, Rory.
Doctor?
There can never be two Amys in the TARDIS. The paradox was too massive.
You can't leave her, she'll die.
Doctor,
no, she'll never have existed. When we save our Amy, this future won't have happened.
Rory, please. Don't let me in.
It's still a gut-wrenching moment, I think, when he stood at the TARDIS door. And I think it changes something in him. And I think his relationship with the Doctor is never going to be the same again after this episode.
Do not be alarmed.
At the end, he gets Amy back, and with the knowledge that, you know, when she gets older, she'll still love him. So it's quite a big thing.